is John Cullen with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming out here from my front yard garden, which I've been actually sweating beads all day working in my garden. Hopefully this time of year, you guys are also working in your garden. And anyways, the topic of this episode is actually a brand new manure product that I learned about, right? And this is the one manure you guys should use over any other manure out there. It comes out of something's butt. Yes, I said it, butt. And it's not human manure, so don't worry, because you guys didn't like my video I did on human manure. Although, if properly done, it could be totally safe. Yes, that being said, this is the best manure, and it's not going to give you E. coli contamination like improperly, you know, composted cow manure or other manures can. And so, actually, I just want to get into it. Actually, I got a buddy, literally a buddy, here in my garden today that's been helping me the last couple of days I've been working with, and he is a bona fide landscaper, gardener. I mean, he knows what he's doing. So we got him right here, and this is Buddy.
How you doing, everybody?
And Buddy has a company called Millipoo. You could see it on there. And what it is, this is actually millipede poop. And so that's just another manure. It's coming out of a creature's butt. And as you guys know, my favorite is like the earthworm castings, and that's probably one of the best manures you guys could use. But the millipede poop, if you guys remember, I'll put a link down below to a video I made actually in Southwest Florida, where I visited a dude's house and he had millipedes on his property, and he told me he collected the millipede poo, and I mentioned it in that video. How many of you guys took action on that, right? Now data is coming out on how beneficial this millipede poop actually is, and it's probably one of the highest fungal dominated additives you could add to your soil mixes, add to your compost teas to get that fungal matter in there that, in my opinion, is so deficient in gardening soils of today. So anyways, Buddy, I want to ask you, like, how did you come up with this millipede poop stuff?
Well, it kind of happened where I was moving some stuff around and noticed the stuff that was in the ground, got some of it, and slowly over a long period of time had it tested to see if there was anything, you know, in there that was going to be viable. And then took that further to some, you know, the serious testing to know how many, what microbes. We've got all the information on, excuse me, the entire plethora of microbes that are available in there. But what really turned out to be the secret was the fungal. That kind of happened by accident. You know, all of a sudden in figuring out how many microbes there was, we sent it into another lab to have it tested for the taking pictures to see what live stuff was in there. And they were just surprised at how much fungi we had compared to bacteria. And, you know, fungi creates that ammonium nitrogen side of the plants that like one or the other, or a blend. So, you know, it really does a nitrogen explosion on top of the microbes. There's some other guys in there. There's a phosphorus solubilizer. There's a free living nitrogen fixing bacteria.
It doesn't need a root association.
Exactly.
That's very, for those of you guys that know what's up, that's what's up.
And I don't have it in a zone where it can go to work. This is all happening in the creation of the product. Now, when it goes out and gets an association with something and goes to work, then the nitrogen is applied to the plant. So, you know, there's quite a benefit to, you know, to this product, and not a lot is needed. You know what I mean? It's a part of an equation, as you well know. The more things you put into the equation, then the better the result is that you get out at the end. And I think that, you know, it's not to replace anything else, but to add something to. It would be beautiful during the flowering time, because flowering time is when you need that ammonium side, and when it's growing in the beginning, so it can be added in. There are also, what was another interesting thing in there was, because it is an ammonium, then there's also a bacteria that was in the bacteria side of the testing that I had done that solubilizes that and makes it a nitrate. So there's even those, because they feel the abundance and they know. So you know, it's made from a hard wood chip, hard to break down, and that causes a lot of fungus. We found some awesome pictures this week, you know, when I went out there to study in the pile. And some mushrooms had come out because it's all hardwood chips, and the millipedes had just come out and just descended on that, which is
on the mushrooms.
On the mushrooms, wow. Literally skinning off where the spores are, and then of course they go back down underground and they disperse that, and everybody kind of re-eats everything in this process. It's not like our feces you want to run from. It's just a part of the whole thing, like baby elephants eat elephant dung to get their microbes going in their children.
So just wanted to take a moment out of this episode today to remind you guys that we're still doing, for a limited time, the Growing Your Greens t-shirt fundraiser. So if you want to support me and my work, you could definitely buy a Growing Your Greens t-shirt that directly supports me to allow me to continue to make my educational videos. Plus, you definitely get a really cool organic cotton Growing Your Greens t-shirt. So yeah, check the link down below, compassiontees.com. Link is also at the end of this video. So when you're done watching the video, click over and support me while you still can, and also get a cool organic t-shirt at the same time. So many people might not know what Buddy does for a living. Actually, he's like a landscaper, and he came upon the millipoo by accident. He didn't like try to like come up with some scheme to kind of like make some product he could sell. How did you actually discover this, Buddy?
Well, actually the story is that I was in the lot next door to my house, and I was using my skid steer, and I had piles of mulch over there that were decomposing, and the machine that I was driving was squeaking, so I knew it needed grease, and I needed to take it back to the other property in order to put some grease in it, and I didn't want to go empty bucketed, let's just say. So I went into the pile, and I got some of what turned out to be this product. Took it next door, and that's when I made a discovery that the top of the pile looked like perfect mulch. It looked like I was gonna get a scoop of mulch, but when it fell over, it was more like coffee grinds. And that kind of started, you know, the revolution.
Right, so like, you know, creatures will break down things, whether that's wood chips or, you know, the fungi will break down the wood chips, and that's kind of like a slower process, but the millipedes get in there and they also break down the wood chips. And many of you guys might have played a game in the 80s called a millipede, or maybe even centipede. And so you guys might not know what these are. They're like multi-segmented creatures. So let me show you guys what these are here. I mean, this is what some of the babies look like. And these are just babies. What do the big ones look like?
Big ones are,
how much longer are they? And do they bite? I mean,
no.
Are they poisonous? I just got bit. No, just kidding.
They have no predators. They live 5 to 7 years. They're mature in right around a year, and this is a young adult. I mean, you know what I mean? They just get a bigger version of that. That's one of the two. That's this yellow one that you see, called the Jamaican bumblebee, and the other called the Florida rusty.
They kind of tickle when they walk on you.
And they don't bite. They actually are known that there's a black bird in Florida called a grackle.
Oh, there's three of them on here. Oh my God.
I got a little baby.
Oh my God, there. Let me put him back in the little cup there.
They're getting away from you.
All right, good.
So they're about double that size.
They live a long time. And then what they produce is basically they eat the wood chips, and you know, Buddy's been feeding them a certain kind of wood chips, not just any old wood. And then they basically eat that, they digest the wood and all the beneficial fungi and bacteria in their guts, basically, get turned into this stuff. And this is like, I don't know, check this out, let me show you guys this. This is like some really nice coffee ground material. Oh look, there's like little babies in there too, I'm seeing them. Smells really neutral, actually, doesn't really smell like much at all.
No, it's very neutral. I was even surprised. I thought it would smell like, you know, like wood or something, but it does not. Yeah, it's very neutral.
So how long does it take the millipede to basically eat the wood and make this?
Well, he's small, so, you know, it's a tiny little pellet, if you will. But takes about 3 years before you have enough that you would consider to really be harvestable. Then after that, your pile is going to be rotting. The process is going to be a little better than that. That first year is kind of slow. And then you need to increase your numbers until they're consuming enough. And you can go in there and test it and check it and see how deep the poo is. And then you can make a decision on when to harvest it. But it's been 3 years. It's really
three
the best,
like...
best results. I mean, that's just right out of the ground. I didn't add water. I didn't
do
anything.
Yeah, it's like nice, rich,
and
like
exactly
black,
what it is.
Good stuff.
There's no
right
little,
there.
Even though I live in Florida, there's like no little shiny sand pieces. I mean, it really
is. Yeah, no, this is
100%
pure. Like,
it
I bought
really
worm castings that have like all kinds of other stuff in there. I mean, this is just 100%
this never
poo.
Makes it down to the dirt. It's never harvested off the ground.
Cool.
It's off of the pile.
So why would you say, and I mean he does sell it, why would you say these are better than earthworm castings?
I wouldn't say they're better than earthworm castings. What I'd say is if you've got an herbaceous plant like the gardening stuff that you do, you are going to be in love with castings and you need a good one, and you talk about that all the time. But if you need a plant that has ammonium, or you're growing fruit trees or something of that nature, especially acidic stuff, you're going to need something that's going to go out and work for you to get you the type of nitrogen that your plant requires. And if you just sit there shoving earthworms castings down its throat and it's not really what it wants to eat, it isn't going to be happy. And so I'm thinking that this right here can do a job that isn't being done. That I've heard you speak about many times. It's hard to get a fungally dominated product. And all the fungally dominated products, information that I've seen of the people that have posted it, have been high in fungi, but there's still more in bacteria. And we actually are 50, 100 times fungi to the bacteria. So I also believe that with earthworm casting, it's a great joiner. So you get the benefit of that and some of this other, and let the whole package polish off a plant in a way that you didn't know. And we know that this, with the phosphorus solubilizers and the form of nitrogen that it creates, is the kind that does the flowering part of all plants, which ultimately is your fruit and the best part that we're all looking for.
Cool. Here, you want to pull up the data on that?
Yeah.
He has the full testing. We don't have the printout today, but it's on his tablet there. But what I want to say to you guys, that I think, you know, nature's about balance. In nature, there's all kinds of different balances, and if you're using, you know, a certain kind of compost that's bacterial based, you know, I think, especially from my travels, my experience, and what I've seen, you need a lot more fungi in there. Not to say that you need like a fungal dominated soil, but there's so much bacteria component in most soils, in my opinion, that adding a good fungal component will only increase your yields, increase your harvest, increase the quality of what you're growing. And so here's the you guys can't see that probably on
they
the screen there.
It, you know what I mean?
But I'm looking at it here, and it's like bacteria results are 43, and the desired range is 300 to 3,000. So if you're looking for a bacterial-based product, this is not it. But if you're looking for a fungi, it has a 1,936, and the range is between 3 to 3,000. And the mean is 0.46, and the standard deviation is 0.42. So what does that mean, buddy?
We're actually, she has a circle on that, the lady who tested my product, because we do want to bring up the bacteria, because as its own product, it needs to stand alone. I can't send it out and say, hey, add some earthworms castings. Certain people aren't going to be able to get that type of product. So we're going to be worried. This is our baseline set of numbers. Now I will begin some inputs that are going to be able to raise those things. We want this standard deviation to be a little bit further apart. And all that means is that we need some bacteria to be, because in my pile, it's one set of circumstances. Hardwood, we want fungi to get it. But when you take it and you apply it where you're going to put it, there's going to be fresh green leaves that just fell, and you're going to need those other retrievers to go out and break those things down in order to turn them into what we're looking for.
I personally like specialized products, though. Like, I want to get the best worm castings that do the best, and I want to get the best millipede poo, because each component is separate, and I like to mix my own formulas. I don't want to get like an all-in-one, because if you're an all-in-one, generally you don't do any one thing particularly better, you know, in my opinion. So buddy, the next question I have for you is, how do you apply this product? Would you mix it into a soil mix? Would you put it in a planting hole? Would you add it to compost teas? Or would you just pour a bunch of it in like a pile of wood chips to like let it start breaking down and get those beneficial microbes and fungi in there?
Boy, honestly, you hit it all. I mean, absolutely. If you lived in another, I live in Southwest Florida. It's extremely humid. It's very wet. Things rot rapidly. Anywhere else, you'd want to add this to your compost pile if you were doing that type of a thing, because this is going to help you rot faster in a better way. And my microbes are going to go in and invade that pile and become more and more available. You definitely would want to use it in a tea, but I think you'd want to use it when the plant is going into flowering, or a couple of weeks into it even. Or if a plant requires this type of nitrogen, then you're going to want it in the tea the whole time. A little bit, you know, is going to help no matter what, but to try to get dominant on that side that we're always saying to make a fungally dominated tea, you have to brew it longer. No, we can take a little castings out, add a little bit more millipoo. Fungi don't really love water. They love dry wood, so you're not gonna do this fabulous job of multiplying the numbers like is normally done in a tea. And that's okay, that's a part of what we have to accept about. So incorporating the soil is number one, especially if you're re-bedding your garden each year, refortifying it with a whole bunch of other elements. I won't have to add a lot of inputs if you're the type of person who already has those inputs and you're adding them in, like you said, as you know, according to the plants that you're growing. So, you know, maybe 5% of your tea mix should be millipoo if you're think you need some ammonium in the nitrogen form for your plants, and as much as 25%, maybe even 30% if you're really trying to put the fungi. But when you pot your plant or the incorporate in the soil for the flowering part of it, you're going to need some stuff in there for them to go to work on. Just putting it in the dirt, they'll die and become food, but they're not going to go in and necessarily do work unless you have those things that they like to work on. And then they just make a better situation for you. We're really not supposed to go and turn over all of our dirt. We just put some mulch on top. These guys would break that down. And then kind of when you come back and plant, you're doing a little bit of an incorporation at that point, and you're not disturbing the hyphae and the rest of the things, because mine are going to create hyphae. And if you know that going into it, then you'll do less disturbing in a garden where this is a requirement.
Cool,
yeah. That makes sense.
So probably one of the best ways to use it, in my opinion, is probably if you guys wood chip your gardens, right? Wood chip your gardens, then incorporate some of this material into it, because now you're literally, like, it's like you're making a yogurt. You're inoculating the fungi onto the wood chips, and then basically, could you stop buying millipoo at that point? Because all the fungi are basically reproducing in your garden, and this is basically just the seed to get you guys
going.
That's
the truth. That's the truth. That's the truth. And that's the open source, you know, type of lifestyle we're trying to exemplify here. There's a lot of people need to do this if we're going to really, really eat like we're supposed to eat and have the quality that we should be having. We're better than this. You know, we can do this easily if everybody just, and I don't mean go to the places and purchase it. I mean get out there and get something done, or join with someone who's doing it where you don't have the whole responsibility, and a group of people can accomplish a lot and eat a lot and probably give a lot away, as you well know. So, you know, 5-10% mixed in the soil, kind of want it in there. I wouldn't say way below the plant. It wouldn't necessarily be something I'd throw in the hole. You know what I mean? Like we do with the mycorrhizae, because they need
I'd throw that in them. I throw earthworm castings in every hole. Yes, I'll just put some of this in there too.
And you absolutely could, but I'd rather it be throughout the whole thing,
sure,
and then you just plant it.
Yeah, well, if you got you know, bucket scoops full that you could spread everywhere, like, you know, most of us are going to have to, you know, get it shipped in. So here's another question for you, buddy. Can people have their own millipedes at home and feed them hardwoods and make their own millipoo?
You kind of could, but you would have, it's a tropical bug. Mm. And I live in this one little spot, the fingernail of Florida, which is the subtropics. There's no other place in the United States of America, not even Corpus Christi, Texas, that meets that as a consistency. So I think it would work. I don't know at what rate. I have a lot of these arthropods and a lot of material for them to eat. I live in a zone where it really grows, and we do a lot of pruning, and, you know, it's close to the wealthy, where they want things pruned and cleaned and looking nice, and so that produces a lot of byproducts in my area because of just the sheer rapid growth. So you can do it. Just like, they're sold online. You can buy both of my millipedes online. They're $5 each.
Oh my
or
God.
5 euros
Maybe
each.
Maybe you should start selling the millipedes.
I thought about
might,
that, but
might make
I don't
more
think
money
so.
Than selling the poop.
Because I could really pick out some really handsome, you know, really big guys, but, you know, no, they need to be working. And, you know, it's a much better we eat good than you have an aquarium of millipedes. But definitely it could be done, but I don't think you could do it on a large enough scale to do much, because you don't have that
the
much
climate.
Indoor, and you kind of have to make that climate, and making that climate's going to cost you, and then that's going to make everything raise up, when I can do it easily.
Yeah, so if you guys live in South Florida or other tropical, subtropical locations without freezing, right? Because they don't stand freezing. They
don't
freeze and then they're frozen.
I mean, like, you know, just up the road, maybe 45 to 100 miles north of me, I think you would begin to, you'd have to have a whole lot more to get a whole lot less, because there would be some loss. And that's just assuming, you know, I have no idea how tough they truly are. But I've talked to people that live in those zones and to see if whether they see them or not, because this bug typically comes out after a rain and my whole house will just be covered with these things. I mean, they'll just be crawling all over the walls. They don't eat anything. You know, they're not a termite. They have mandibles, but those mandibles are not for destroying. It's more the fungi and like a, almost like a cow would chew the grass off the earth. They kind of get that surface off of there.
Yeah.
They're not really going in there.
No, like that's kind of like earthworms. Earthworms do the same thing. They don't like eat the food. They eat the bacteria on the food.
They work in conjunction because an earthworm lives below the soil, and this lives literally right there. And they cross one another's paths. The earthworm comes up and the millipede goes down in that little layer, like when you have a pot that's been on the ground for a long time and you move it and there's earthworms underneath. That's because that climate has been established and created under that pot, even though it's above ground, and they're going to take advantage of that. And so I see these guys all the time. I mean, I could go around with a vacuum and get them, but they don't do any damage unless you already have rotting wood. Then they're going to say, yummy,
they're on it.
And they're probably going to get
on it. That's their nice home that they like to live in. So check this out. Buddy, maybe your next product is you're going to have the millipedes on top with all the rotting wood, right? And then below the earth, you're going to just have tons of earthworms and worms. So will the worms eat the millipede poop? It's like eating shit.
It is. And I'm actually going to be making a product called millipede bonbons. Earthworm bonbons. Earthworm bonbons. Because when you take a loop and you put some of this stuff, when you get it and you should do it and put it out, in your hand and look at it under a loop, you can see exactly it's a little oval egg-shaped perfect turd.
It's like a bonbon.
It will absolutely, it looks like a bonbon. You can put it, I put it in water in South Florida heat for 3 days, and every day I stirred it 3 or 4 times before I knew anything about tea. I was just doing this steep thing to see what would happen. And when I poured it through a cloth to get the tea out, what dried up turned out to look just like this all over again. It stays in a
prill.
It does not liquefy and turn into, say, if you mix it with sand and water, it would not turn into muddy sand. It would turn into sand with part, unless you overforced and broke the prill.
So how, if you're trying to just water it in and set it in, and you're watering it in, will the nutrients leach off, or the bacteria, the fungi leach off, or how does that, or they're just living within there, then they kind of branch out and find a new place to live? Or
I think what happens is, they do leach out, but I believe from all the study that I've done, they're nature's slow release. Everything I've read says that if you have wood chips, let's just say, and you put millipede feces on top of it, the millipede feces will break down slower than the wood chips. So it like pre-digests before the rest of the millipedes get in there. At the same time, the fungi get in, because wood chips are large chunks. They're not, they have airspace in between. They're not, you know, there's just more airspace in between, and that allows the fungi to grow in there. And the fungi does not grow 6-8 feet into the pile. It literally only grows on that top maybe 14 inches so far in my examination. And the millipedes live within those 14 inches. So when we harvest 14 inches off of a pile. The rest of the pile stays there, and then everything comes back and goes back on that pile again until it's ready a year later. I think you need 3 years to get started, and then on the fourth year, you'll be doing it once every year, because the pile will really be breaking down in Southwest Florida much more rapidly. If you start with 8 feet, and then 7 feet, and then 6 feet, by the time you get to 5 feet, she's breaking down quick. But I did a pile that was 3 years old in the beginning here before I really knew what was going on, and literally in the middle of that pile was still a section that was untouched by anything, except I could see the mycelia of the fungi just invading it. So we're going in the woods, finding the proper breakdown mushrooms, adding them to it. We want it to be more fungally dominated, but we want to bring up. So we're onto the earthworm thing, though. I do believe that we're going to be feeding it to earthworms because they're great blenders. And then they're going to blend it with other things that otherwise it couldn't get and then it's going to be released really in a new form. And then the same fungi that live in there, when they looked in the, under the microscope, they were surprised and told me that the fungi that were there were like spores that had germinated and not propagules and spores like we get with the mycorrhizae, which is great. That works perfectly in that form. These are actually the little entities themselves. And then that makes them more of something that doesn't have to come to life. It just has to keep on going in a new environment. And so I think the earthworms are going to be a help. I don't really know yet. I'm excited to see that. I want to know that. Somebody has earthworms and has a good resulting test, literal good one from their castings, and then adds it to it. And then gets another one of those tests, and we're going to see what's going on. Yeah. I don't have earthworms. I intend on having them for my own garden because I live very near the ocean, which is where it's very bacterially dominated. And so I need that product as well, and I don't want to ship it in. So we're going to be learning more about that. But right now, it's millipoo, millipoo, millipoo.
Cool. Well, I'm really looking forward to it. I mean, you guys know that I'm really excited about fungal-based compost or additives you could use in your garden, and this is just yet another one. Whether you want to let wood chips degrade down for a couple 3 years to get that nice black fungal dominated compost out of just a pile that hasn't been moved, or even the millipede poo. I think the millipede poo is even better because basically is undisturbing a wood pile for 3 years, so that's doing its own breakdown. But then the millipedes are on top of that, adding additional special sauce. Our time's coming to an end today. Do you have any other final comments or things you'd like to share with my viewers today before we sign off?
I would. I would say leaf mold mulch is your best friend, and not necessarily trying to find wood chips and get these things in there, because leaf mold is already known to be fungal. So a little handful of this doesn't have to be a much, just to release somebody in there and get them going. And then apply that to the top of your garden when you're finished planting for those plants that are looking for what we've been talking about here today about ammonium and that form of nitrate. So, or that form of nitrogen. So that would be the one thing. Other than that, you know, you can reach us at millipoo.com. And, you know, we're going to be setting up a special prize for GYG people. And looking forward to making relationships with and hearing what people think of it.
All right.
And that's what's important to us now.
Cool. Sounds really good. So, I mean, here's the product right here. I don't know what sizes. This is still a little bit early to figure out the sizes that he's going to offer, but check out the website for sure. And I want to give a special thanks out to Josh of the Boogie Brew Company. You guys know, I mean, he makes the best compost tea out there that I use in my very garden. And he's going to start actually incorporating the millipoo into his compost tea to kick that up even better. And that's why Josh has the best compost tea, because he's always looking for new stuff to add to his tea to make it better, where most people have the same recipe year after year, right? And I'm like that with my diet. And I want to encourage you guys to do that with your gardening, with your diet, with your life. When you find something a little bit better, and always be searching, when you find something better, make some minor changes and adjustments all the way along. And I'm sure, you know, Buddy has learned that the millipedes like certain kind of woods and not others, and when he does these kind of woods and stuff, I mean, we won't get into that because we're at the end of the episode. But yeah, so check out the links down below. Also check the links down below to some Josh and Buddy videos, so you guys could learn more about the millipoo there, because Josh has his own series of videos with this guy who's super knowledgeable. Once again, I'm really looking forward to using the millipoo product in my gardens, adding them to my mixtures. I'm going to do some testing, you know, when I have enough product to do it, to see like what happens when I use that with earthworm castings, and then when I, you know, only use the earthworm castings. So if you guys enjoyed this episode, right, Buddy came to my garden this time. If you want me to go to his place in Southwest Florida,
you absolutely
be sure to thumbs this video up. If I get over 1,000 thumbs ups, right, I'll go there, and I will be posting, or if I didn't post already, the OGS video soon, for those of you guys who have been waiting for that, because I did get over 1,000 thumbs up on that video. But I will make it there, and I will film the millipedes, and I'll probably dive in and let them crawl over me.
It's
kind of crazy.
We'll do it together.
But yeah, so thumbs it up if you want me to be there. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes. I'll be coming out about every 3 to 4 days, no matter where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,300 episodes at this time teach you guys all aspects on how you guys grow the highest quality.
I watch them.
Food at home. That you're not going to see anywhere else. I mean, who else has videos on the millipoo, right? Nobody yet. I'm probably one of the first people out there, and I'd like to bring you guys the cutting edge stuff that you're not going to see anywhere else. And if you guys have friends or buddies that are into growing, whether they're medicinals or whether they're herbs or whether they're vegetables or fruits, send them this video so that they could watch it too, because this is going to be one of the biggest advances, mark my words, you know, in the industry in a long time. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.